Good evening and welcome to Revelation of Hope. We are just delighted that you're here. Last evening we had an amazing meeting with more than 500 people. And do you know, last evening these meetings are being streamed, and we stream them to 54 countries around the world, countries as far away as Zimbabwe and Zambia on the continent of Africa, countries in the Middle East where Qatar, and got a report out of Saudi Arabia, the Philippines, out in Asia. And it's just amazing to begin to look at where these meetings are being being streamed to. Now, when you came in tonight, did you scan your scanner card? How many of you have scanner cards? Can I see them? That's great. Now, if you wonder what I'm talking about with scanner cards, there is a registration card for the series. Now, there's no charge for this series, of course, but there's a registration card. We use the registration card so that we can improve our advertising, so next time more people can come. But also, as you scan each evening, we want to build for you what I like to call a library of faith. So each evening when you leave, you get a copy of the presentation for that evening. We have them in English, French, and Spanish. So just indicate what you need. We have translations going in the Spanish language also, and in French, live during this series. And if you need a headphone, we'll certainly be happy to provide one for you in whatever language, either French or Spanish, that you need. Our translators will translate the material live each evening. In addition to the lecture that you'll receive, you also, after you've been here four nights, I've prepared a book called Hope Beyond Tomorrow. Hope Beyond Tomorrow talks about the prophecies of the Bible, but it talks about the pandemic that we have just gone through and how that relates to the prophecies. And you will find it really fascinating. Once you're here four nights, on the fifth night, we'll give you that book. How do we know you're here four nights? Because you scan in with your scanner card, and then it'll come up on our computer database, and we'll say, when you come, we'll have a list of names of those that came those four nights, and then we will be able to give you your book. If you're here on six of the seven presentations, there's a hardback book called Secrets of Prophecy. It takes you through the major prophecies of the book of Daniel and Revelation, and you'll be able to get that book after six nights. So when you come night after night, you get the lectures each evening, the books, and you will build yourself a prophetic library of faith. Each summary of the lecture also has the Bible texts, and you can review in those Bible texts what we've gone over in the lecture itself. Now, most of you have our schedule, our brochure called Revelation of Hope, that has all of the lecture schedule in it. Is there anybody that didn't get one of these brochures? Just raise your hand if you didn't get one, and our ushers will be sure to bring them to you if you need one of the brochures, or you can ask them on the way out. Also, scanner cards. Is there anybody that didn't get a registration card that would like one? You just raise your hand if you didn't get a registration card, and ushers just walk up and down the aisles, and be sure to have scanner cards and brochures with you so that you can give them to anybody that needs them during the presentation or before we begin that presentation. Tonight, Pastor Wilson's going to talk about history's final climax, Revelation's final events. Have you ever wondered what superpower will rule the world next? Have you ever wondered whether it will be China? Will it be Russia? Will the United States rise to superpower status? What superpower will rule the world next? There's a prophecy in the book of Daniel that correlates with the prophecies of Revelation that take us down the stream of time and reveal clearly where this world is headed. Don't think that this world is in the hands of man, because this prophecy reveals historical fulfillment of nation after nation after nation. You're going to see history come alive before your eyes on the screen. It's one of the most amazing prophecies in the Bible. Then tomorrow night, on Monday night, the topic is the battle for the throne. The battle for the throne. Have you ever wondered, if God is so good, why is the world so bad? Why must innocent people suffer? You will find an answer for that tomorrow in the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation reveals a cosmic conflict between good and evil. One of the questions that I'm asked more than any other as I travel the world is, Pastor Mark, why does God allow innocent people to suffer? Why is there so much heartache and suffering in our world? You'll discover the answer to that tomorrow night. As we enter into our presentations tonight, I'm going to ask my friend, Pastor Kevin Rogers, to come. Pastor Rogers is the pastor of the Capital City Church, an amazing church right here in Indianapolis, one of the sponsoring churches of this series. So, Pastor, pray for us as we begin. Would you be so kind to bow your heads with us?
Amen. Father in heaven, we are so thankful for the gift of life today. We are thankful for your word and for the opportunity that we have today to come and to study your word and to learn and to grow and to understand, Lord, where we are in time and what you're about to do in the world. And so we pray that the Spirit of God would fill our hearts and fill every person that is not only here in this building, but that is witnessing this series, Lord, wherever they are in the world, Father. We ask your blessing and that give us understanding, and may our hearts be receptive to your word, Lord, so that we would be better prepared for your coming. In the name of Jesus, we ask a special blessing upon Pastor Wilson there, God, that the Spirit of God would fall upon him mightily and give him clarity of thought, and may his words, Lord, bring inspiration and hope. In Jesus' name, we thank you and we praise you. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. And there's a gospel choir from Capital City Pastor's Church in Glendale, and they're going to bring us a musical selection. We really believe that music lifts our spirits, encourages our hearts, and draws us closer to our Lord. So thank you, Gospel Choir, Capital City Glendale, for coming to be with us.
Burned with a load of care.
Take it to the Lord in prayer. Thank you so much. We believe in prayer here. In fact, each evening before this meeting starts, there's a prayer group that meets, and we're praying that God's Spirit will come and move deeply on hearts. If there is some burden that you have, a financial burden, a marital burden, a health burden, just let one of our staff know, and we are more than happy to pray for you. You know, in the book of Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, God is talking about the second coming of Christ through the Apostle Paul. And the Apostle Paul concludes his letter to the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians. He says, "May the God of peace sanctify you wholly, body, mind, and spirit." So human beings are whole. They're physical, they're mental, they're spiritual. And here at Revelation of Hope, we want to do everything we can to enhance the quality of your life. We want not only to share with you prophecies that will help you to prepare for tomorrow, but we want you to live a healthy life today. My wife, Ernestine, has, or I call her Teeny affectionately. Teeny, come on out. Teeny's been giving health lectures now for how many years has that been?
53.
Yeah, 53 real blessing.
Years she's been giving health lectures around the world. Now,
yeah, that was,
in addition
that
to managing
uplifting
me,
for the attendees.
She ran her first marathon when she was 70 years old. 26.2 miles. Then, when she was 75, what'd you do when you were 75?
Yep.
Yes, well, the Lord ran another marathon.
Brought a number of
she
people.
Ran a
more people will come
at
tonight.
75 years old, at 26.2 miles, came in second
right
in her category.
Biblical
she's
prophecy.
Talk about that a little later.
So you helped add to it.
She's been teaching health,
thanks for playing last night and tonight.
For years and years and years. So
let me just,
she wants to help you
let
to
me
be
just
able to
pray
run
with you all for a minute.
75. No. You know, people are dying of heart disease, cancer. They're
for the church.
And look, there
just
are ways
ask that you
that
will
you can
come close
help.
To them in their continued ministry to people.
His white microphone is on. we just want to shut off a microphone that was on in the back. But she's going to help you to live longer, healthier, and happier. So what do you got for us tonight?
Well, good evening. And welcome to Revelation of Hope's Secrets to Wellness. And so we're going to talk about wellness, but what is wellness? Well, wellness has to do, if we can get the clicker going here, wellness has to do with the whole person. It has to do with the whole person. Wellness includes the mental, the emotional, the physical, the social, and the spiritual. And all of these factors have to be in balance in order to really experience wellness. So is health a matter of chance, or is it a matter of choice, my friends? Yes, it's not like throwing the dice and coming up with some people get these diseases and some people don't. Do our lifestyle choices really make a difference? Well, they do. In fact, our lifestyle choices may help or harm our health only a little, but when these choices become habits over years and then decades, the results may become major. In other words, someone says, "I'm young, I can do what I want. If I want to smoke, I'll smoke. If I want to drink alcohol, I'll drink alcohol. If I want to be sedentary and not exercise, it's my body, I can do what I want." But when these choices become habits over years and then decades, they can either help or they can harm our health. There's an old saying that says, "Sell your health when you're young, and when you're old, you can't buy it back." So our lifestyle choices play a key role in determining both the quality and the length of our lives. And so, my friends, you can live longer, healthier, and happier by making the right lifestyle choices. In fact, recent scientific scientific studies have shown that we can add an extra 10 to 12 years to our life. How many want to add an extra 10 or 12 years? Yes, we all do. But by our lifestyle choices, we can contribute to premature aging. So the choice is yours and the choice is mine. But someone says, wait a minute, it's my genetics. I'm overweight because my mother was, or my father was, or I have diabetes because someone in my family had it. But Luigi Fontana, who's a physician and the co-director of the Longevity Research Program at Washington University in St. Louis, says approximately 25% of your risk of death is due to genetics. Now, he's not even saying your risk of the disease, but the risk of death is due to genetics. How much is left? Yes, 75% remains. And he says, diet is likely the most important factor, even more than exercise. And I believe in exercise. We need to keep moving. And especially as we get older, we need to keep moving and we need to exercise. But diet is also very important. So, are Americans living more healthfully? How are Americans living today? Let's take a look at that. 900,000 Americans die prematurely every year from the leading causes of death. So let's look at what those killer diseases are of the 21st century. What are the major killer diseases? Well, the killer diseases today are lifestyle-related diseases, diseases that are largely the result of our poor health choices. So what are they? Well, heart disease is number one here in America, and I've done health programs around the world, and basically heart disease is the number one killer worldwide. Sometimes cancer may be number one. Cancer is number two here in the United States. And then unintentional injuries, which includes actually wrong drugs and accidents. And then there's chronic lower respiratory diseases or your lung diseases and stroke. And then Alzheimer's disease, my friends. This is a scary disease, and it's continuing to rise higher and higher here in America and also around the world. And then diabetes. Diabetes is on the all-time rise, and childhood diabetes is rising as well. And then influenza, pneumonia, kidney disease, and then suicide. And unfortunately, during COVID-19 and during this terrible pandemic, many suicides took place, and so that is rising as well. What about Americans' health today? They have high blood pressure. Nearly half, 45.6% of American adults have high blood pressure. And this is according to the American Heart Association. So almost half have high blood pressure. High cholesterol, 33.5% of American adults have high cholesterol. That's LDL. That's the bad cholesterol. And high cholesterol, they have twice the risk of heart disease as people with lower levels of cholesterol. And what about obesity and overweight? Well, 2 out of 3 adults here in America are either overweight or obese. According to the latest statistics, it's actually up to 66.6% now, of Americans, 2/3 of Americans are either overweight and or obese, and 31% of them are obese. And so we have some work to do so that we can live longer, healthier, and happier. And every year, excess body weight is thought to be responsible for 132,800 cases of even cancer in the United States of America. What are those cancers? Well, breast cancer, colon cancer, esophagus, gallbladder, kidney, and uterus cancer. And the American Cancer Society predicts that the number of cancer cases will increase to 500,000 nationwide by 2030 if the current trend continues. So we need to get some remedies for this, right, my friends? Because what about America's health today? They are inactive, sedentary. In fact, 77% of American adults don't even get enough exercise. And it's not that difficult, or because the recommendation is only even 30 minutes a day for 5 days a week. Now, we could even do more of that if we really want to be healthy, but that's the recommendation. What about America's health today? We have a poor diet and lack of nutrition. So we're going to talk about that. Poor diet. It's the foods they are eating, the junk foods, the processed foods, the high protein foods, the fast foods, but also it's lack of nutrition because of the fact that they're eating so many of these other kinds of foods. It's the foods they're not eating, the foods that are high in your vitamins, your minerals, your phytochemicals, your antioxidants, and those are the ones that we need to stay healthy. So here, let's take a look at America's health today. We have high blood pressure, high cholesterol with LDL, obesity, inactivity, poor diet, lack of nutrition, and these lifestyle practices are what lead to the chronic diseases. Now, let me illustrate this way, because when people develop these diseases, they want to seek for a cure. Now, they say, "Can you help me?" But sometimes, and even oftentimes, it's too late. So let me illustrate this way. There's a famous old monastery situated on the side of a cliff. We've been up that monastery, and the monastery overlooked the emerald blue waters of the Mediterranean. And a tourist wanted to visit this monastery, but there was a problem. And the one problem was the only way up was in an old wicker basket hoisted up by a rope. Now, we walked up the stairs when we went up that monastery, but we saw that basket up there, and we even saw the rope, but people walk up today. And so when the visitor got into the basket, he asked a question. I only have one question. How often do you change the rope? And this is how he answered. "Oh, don't worry. We change it every time it breaks." Now, you know, we kind of chuckle about that, but if we relate that to our health, sometimes we want to change it when it's broken. And sometimes it's too late. And so, how can we avoid or even reduce these killer diseases of cancer, heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, stroke, obesity, all of these things? Well, my friends, a pill is not going to do it. It's not going to be through some magic pill. No, there's no miracle strength pill, and there are really no shortcuts. It's a matter of making good choices. Because when we make good choices, we can live longer. And God has given us great insights, great health insights in His Word. And these are the true secrets to wellness. Now, they're not going to be secrets anymore because I'm telling them to you. And I want you to tell them to others, because you see, the Bible's ancient health principles are a universal prescription for wellness. In fact, I've used these around the world. It doesn't matter if we're in India or in Africa or in the United States of America or in Europe or wherever we are, they work around the world because you can find them right in the Bible. In the book of Genesis, you will see that at creation, God placed the first human beings, Adam and Eve, in a garden with adequate exercise and pure water and clean, fresh air and abundant sunshine and a natural diet and rest of body and peace of mind, instructing them to exercise self-control, trusting in Him, trusting in God. And so these are the true remedies. So here they are. In a book called Ministry of Healing, page 127, it says, pure air, sunlight, abstemiousness, we'll talk about that, rest, exercise, proper diet, the use of water, trust in divine power, these are the true remedies. These are the true remedies that will reduce the risk of these killer diseases. So you see, my friends, God has principles for good health. He has given us 8 simple principles to achieve better health. Does it sound simple? Well, it is simple, but it takes discipline to put them into practice. And that's the key. And here they are, all wrapped up in the word wellness. In the word wellness, you'll be able to remember it easily because it's all in the word wellness. Water, exercise, love and trust in God, and then lifestyle, or abstemiousness, and temperance, and then nutrition, and environment, the air, pure air, sunshine, and sleep. These are the true remedies. So let's start and just briefly go over a few. We'll actually do a little more on these in the next few meetings, but we'll start with just water and do a few things. Just breeze through them quickly. Scientific studies reveal the following benefits of just drinking adequate amounts of water. It's going to improve your digestion, purify your blood, enhance circulation, and even eliminate those toxins from your body, and increase energy. You want more energy? Then maybe you need to drink a little more water. Yes, and we're going to show the benefits of even hydrotherapy, and there are many benefits of water on the inside and water on the outside. And then exercise is a law of life. It's important. And so what's principle number one? Just to exercise regularly, and when you do, you'll have half the risk of these killer diseases than as inactive people. So we want to exercise. Because you see, my friends, exercise is just as important as a good diet. It's very important to keep moving, especially as you get a little older. We need to keep moving. We need to keep active. So make exercise a priority. We'll talk a little more about this in later meetings as well. But my husband and I make exercise a priority out there in the open air. It doesn't matter whether it's rain or shine, snow or blow, whatever it is, we'll take our umbrellas, we'll put on our hat, our mittens, our gloves, whatever, and go out there and exercise, because that's so important. So that should be a priority. And then there is love and trust in God. You see, love has unusual healing power. Studies have shown that people do better even when they're sick, when they have love. And health is improved when we trust in God's unconditional love. Yes, John 3:16, you know that text so well. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So my friends, just trust in divine power is healing. It is one of God's laws of health. So 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your care upon him, for he cares for you. That's another one of God's remedies. And then there's lifestyle. What is that? That's temperance or abstemiousness, abstaining from everything that is harmful. Like abstaining from drugs and alcohol, tobacco, and even caffeine. And so what else is temperance? It is using wisely that which is good. That means we have many good foods, we have many good things, but we want to use them temperately. Yes, so that is very important for our health. Yes. And then there's nutrition. I love nutrition. I started teaching nutrition and cooking schools back in 1969. So 53 years ago, I started teaching nutrition. I love teaching classes on nutrition because, you see, good nutrition is essential for good health. And we're going to talk about that. Nancy and I are going to talk about that one night together. And we're going to have fun sharing with you how you can live longer, healthier, and even happier when you have good nutrition. But how do you know what to choose? What foods do you choose? Well, the Bible gives us a good clue. In Genesis 1:29, it says this, "And God said, see, I have given you every plant-yielding seed that is on the face of all the land, and every tree with seed in its fruit, and you shall have them for food." So God gave us fruits, nuts, grains, and vegetables. And now scientific evidence is showing that is the best diet. That's the protective diet toward these killer diseases. You see, the Eden diet was a plant-based vegetarian diet. Yes, yes. Yes, we'll talk to you later about that, okay? Yes. Enjoy better health and longevity when you eat a plant-based diet. Science is showing this. Clearly, this is the best. Yes, Cheryl Rock, PhD, a professor of family medicine and public health at the University of California, San Diego School of Medicine, says this, "The science is clear. Eating the right foods can lead to a longer, healthier life." So what are some of the ways that we can even reduce the risk of cancer? By eating a good, healthy, plant-based diet. Plant foods are a powerful medicine filled with adequate nutrients. And so we have all of these remedies, and then there's environment. Our environment is so vital to our health. It's either health restoring or health destroying. And so pure air, my friends, enhances the immune system. Look at just what pure air does. It improves our happiness, improves digestion, improves blood pressure and heart rate, improves energy, improves lung function, improves brain power, even mental health, and improves our immune system. And when we have a strong immune system, we can even fight off or reduce the risk of some of these killer diseases. So just walk out among the trees. You see, the trees purify the air. There's health-giving, life-giving properties even in the trees. And then there's sunshine, another one of God's remedies. Incorporate sunshine into your lifestyle because it is another one of the remedies that will keep us healthy. And of course, last but not least is sleep. Sleep is so important. Are we getting enough sleep? Do you know how much sleep you need? Do you have sleep debt? How can you tell if you have sleep debt? Well, we all benefit physically, mentally, socially, and spiritually from adequate rest and sleep. Why is sleep so necessary? Because it restores our energy, it replenishes our strength, it relieves stress, revitalizes our nerves, and even rebuilds our immune system. There it is again. We need to have a strong immune system to even fight off this pandemic of COVID-19. And so there's so many things that sleep does for us. But we need daily sleep, and we need also a weekly sleep. And my friends, when we choose to cooperate with God and follow His laws of health, He promises that He will strengthen us. There's no question about it. God promises us to give us abundant health when we follow His secrets to wellness. And this is why I've written my book on Secrets to Wellness, because I want you, and I want others, I want my friends, I want the people that I'm having classes with to live longer, healthier, and happier. And you can when you choose God's Health Assurance Plan, because Jesus says, in 3 John 2, "Beloved, I pray or I wish that you may prosper in all things and be in health as your soul prospers." So may God bless you, my friends, as you choose God's way, because God's way is always the best way.
We want you to live longer, healthier, and happier in this series. And, you know, when we look at Bible prophecy, it reveals that something great and decisive is about going to happen. But we can have hope and confidence in the Christ who's coming again. Jesus provides for us hope for the future. Last night, Pastor Wilson talked about signs of the times are everywhere. There's a brand new feeling in the air. Matthew chapter 24 is being fulfilled with all those signs of the times. Listen as Charles comes to sing that amazing song, "Signs of the Times Are Everywhere." Right after that, Pastor Wilson will enter right into his Bible lecture for the evening on the history of the world and the unfolding of world events in the next superpower that will dominate the world. Charles?
Years of time have come and gone since we first heard it told, how Jesus would come again someday. If back then it was so real, I just can't help but feel how much closer its coming is today. Signs of the times are everywhere, and there's a brand new feeling in the air. Keep your eyes upon the eastern sky. Lift up your head. Redemption draweth nigh. And war and strife on every hand, and violence fill the land. Still some people doubt he'll come again, but the word of God is true. He'll redeem his chosen few. So don't lose hope. Soon Christ Jesus will descend. Signs of the time are everywhere, and there's a brand new feeling in the air. Keep your eyes upon the eastern sky. Lift up your head. Lift up your head. Lift up your head. Redemption draws nigh.
Thank you so much, Charles. And Lisa, thank you for this wonderful reminder that the signs of the times are everywhere, and our redemption draweth nigh. I want to thank you for coming tonight. I have to tell you, the Bible is full of beautiful messages from Genesis to Revelation. But there are a particular few areas that are even more exciting to speak about, and tonight happens to be one of them. When we look at prophecy, we can see in Scripture how God has foreknowledge, how he predicts things will happen, and it verifies not only the Bible, it absolutely confirms God is omnipotent. He is omniscient. He understands and knows and reveals to us through his word that which will take place. And so tonight, we're going to be having a very special focus in our journey in the book of Revelation. We're also going to be going to the companion prophetic book in the Old Testament that you cannot do without, Daniel and Revelation. It's going to be a fascinating journey, and I know that God will bless as we look at these powerful, wonderful understandings of Revelation's biggest surprise. You see, the topic for tonight is something that will help us to fix our minds on that which is coming. Now, what parent hasn't looked into the face and the eyes of a newborn child and asked the question, I wonder what holds the future for my little one? You see, the amazing aspects of what God has done in terms of helping us to understand our children and our grandchildren need to have a beautiful place in which to grow up. You know, questions are asked like, is there anybody in control of this world? And is there any place we can find information, reliable information about the future? And who can we really, really trust? God's word is helping us to understand these wonderful things. And in Deuteronomy 29, verse 29, it says, the secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and to our children forever. Over 2,500 years ago, God revealed one of his secrets to an ancient pagan king. And the message that he revealed is for you and for me, for us and for our children today. It gives us hope. It gives us confidence that the destiny of this world is in the hands of God. And one day, he's going to put an end to sickness and suffering and war and shame and poverty and death. Tonight, we're going to take a journey through history to discover God's plans for this world. Now, here's an interesting theme that I want you to fix in your mind and understand fully. We believe this completely because, as I said last night, don't just take the word of Pastor Wilson or Pastor Finley or some other pastor. Look it up in the scripture for yourself. So here's our theme. If it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it disagrees with the Bible, then it's not for me. So the study tonight is going to demonstrate that absolute truth. The Word of God is absolutely reliable. We can count upon it. Now let's go back in time about 600 years before Christ was on earth to an ancient king's bedroom. One night, King Nebuchadnezzar, the great king of Babylon, had a fascinating dream. And he woke up in the morning and he could not remember the dream. But he knew it must be more than just an ordinary dream. Indeed, it was a dream given by God himself to the great king of Babylon. It was outlining history for the next 2,500 years. You see, it was an amazing prophetic understanding found in the second chapter of Daniel. It says in verse 1, "Now in the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, and his spirit was so troubled that his sleep left him." Now the king was just so overwrought by this, he couldn't understand and couldn't even remember the dream. He called all of his wise men, astrologers, magicians, sorcerers, all these Chaldeans to the royal palace. And he said to them, "Now, tell me what I dreamed last night and tell me what the significance of that dream is." "What is the meaning of what I dreamed?" Well, the wise men replied in verse 4, we read it, "O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream and we will give the interpretation." Now, King Nebuchadnezzar got a little bit annoyed. You don't want to annoy a king of an empire. "I don't know what I dreamed." God mysteriously took it from his mind. Now the king goes on in verse 9. "Therefore, tell me the dream and I shall know that you can give me its interpretation." In other words, he was pushing these sorcerers and magicians to the wall. He says, "Don't pretend that you know when you really don't know. You're supposed to see the future. You tell me what I dreamed." And the Chaldeans protested even more. Verse 10, "There is not a man on earth who can tell the king's matter." And that was absolutely true. There was no one on earth who could do what the king had asked. Only the God in heaven could reveal a dream that this king had in his bedroom. Only the God of heaven can accurately, precisely reveal the future. Now the king became so angry, he rashly ordered the execution of all of these wise men, Chaldeans, and others. Well, the news reached Daniel. Daniel was not a psychic. He wasn't one of these strange sorcerers, but he was one of the king's wise men. When Daniel asked why he was going to be killed, as well as all the rest, Arioch, the executioner, told him the story about the dream and the king. So Daniel went into the king, respectfully, of course, and he said, "King, give me some time. Let me go and pray and ask the God of heaven, the God who will reveal the dream that you had in your bedroom. The God of heaven will reveal the future to me. I will return and explain to you what you dream." Now in the night vision, God revealed the dream and its interpretation to his servant Daniel. You see, Daniel was a follower and believer of the true God in a foreign country. He had been taken there by force, but he remained true to God. May every one of you be as true as Daniel was to biblical principles, to God himself. Well, God revealed the dream to Daniel. Daniel prayed. In verse 23, "I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and might." So God revealed it to Daniel. He went in to see the king and he told him that while it is true that no wise men, no astrologer, no magician, no sorcerer, no Chaldean could reveal the dream, that the God in heaven, who is the absolute arbiter of all that which is good could reveal secrets. And he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Now, this is a very key phrase. I want you to take note of that. So this prophecy takes us all the way down through the stream of time. It takes us from Daniel's day, down through the nations of Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome, and it takes us down to the divided empires of Europe itself. And then it takes us down to that key phrase. What is it? The latter days. Verse 31 in Daniel chapter 2. You, O king, were watching, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose splendor was excellent, stood before you, and its form was awesome. In verse 32 and 33, it says, this image's head was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, and the legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. In verse 34, Daniel recounts, you watched while a stone was cut out without man's hands, which struck the image on the feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed together and became like chaff from the summer threshing floors. The wind carried them away so that no trace of them was found. And the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Well, Daniel said, this is the dream. Now we will tell the interpretation of it before the king. Can you imagine the absolute amazement and fixation on this that King Nebuchadnezzar had? Well, Daniel continued, you, O king, are a king of kings, and you are this head of gold. You see, the head of gold represented Babylon or Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom. Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom ruled the world from 605 BC to 539 BC. In fact, Nebuchadnezzar established one of the most fantastic empires in the entire world. The kingdom was lavishly adorned with gold. Babylon was the wealthiest kingdom in the world at that time. It had luxurious gardens, including the famous Hanging Gardens, a wonder of the ancient world. Babylon was large, 10 miles on a side, 16 kilometers, for those of you watching all over the world. In fact, Pastor Finley mentioned 54 countries were watching this coming from Indianapolis. This is an amazing feat of electronic distribution in our world today. Rome, in comparison, was only 6 miles and Athens 4 miles on a side. So Babylon was a large city. The temple of Marduk, you see it pictured there in this artistic drawing, was 300 feet or 91 meters high. Outside it was covered with blue glazed tile. You can imagine how glorious it was in the sun. Inside it was overlaid with gold. In fact, in that one temple alone, this temple to Marduk, Nebuchadnezzar used 18 tons of gold. You see why God used the symbol of gold to describe Babylon? Because its chief god, Bel-Marduk, was sitting in a lavish golden temple. Bel-Marduk, this chief god of the Babylonians, was a golden image on a golden throne before a golden altar beside a golden candlestick. 8.5 tons of solid gold were used for the altar and the throne just alone. No wonder God said to Nebuchadnezzar, "You are this head of gold." Well, Daniel's prophecy goes on. Verse 32, its chest and arms of silver. You see, after Babylon, another kingdom would arise, the Medes and the Persians. They overthrew the Babylonians. You don't have to guess at the meaning of the prophecy. You just look at verse 39. What do the arms and the breast of silver represent? It says, after you shall arise another kingdom. You see, Bible prophecy predicted the nation of Babylon would not last forever. Another kingdom would arise. History reveals exactly how that happened. In Daniel chapter 5, and again, remember these two books, Daniel in the Old Testament, Revelation in the New, and there are many other references of prophecy, certainly in other books, Matthew 24, we looked at that last night, but Daniel and Revelation are so intertwined, and they give us a key to the future. Daniel chapter 5, King Belshazzar, the grandson of King Nebuchadnezzar, hosted a drunken feast for 1,000 of his lords. As the wine was flowing and the music was playing, long-robed men held close, lavishly dressed Babylonian women, in the midst of the drunken debauchery, the enchanting music, and the seductive immorality at that huge event, God interrupted Belshazzar's feast. A bloodless hand, a very dynamic illustration of God's power, wrote upon the wall these particular words, "Mene, God has numbered your kingdom and finished it. Tikal, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. Peres, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians." Daniel's interpretation can be verified by any good history book on Babylon. Cyrus, the general of the armies of the combined countries of Media and Persia, overthrew the proud kingdom of Babylon. Daniel was not the only one who predicted this. In fact, God named Cyrus approximately 150 years before Cyrus was even born. Look at this amazing prophecy written by the prophet Isaiah sometime around 600 or so BC. It says, "Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held to subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors so that the gates will not be shut." Now that's exactly what happened in the conquest of Babylon. His soldiers, Cyrus's, dug canals to divert the great Euphrates River, which went through Babylon, so that it dried up the riverbed in Babylon itself. And they came into the city marching through the riverbed. You see, the Bible is not an ordinary book. When you and I open God's word, we are opening the word of the living God, and the prophecies are absolutely true. Well, the prophecy continues. Next, a third empire was depicted by the thighs of brass. Then another, a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. You see, Alexander the Great led his armies with their bronze helmets, their bronze breastplates, their bronze shields, their bronze-handled swords. The Greek armies dominated the world with lightning speed. It was an amazing conquest that Alexander had with his armies. So we have Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece. But would Greece rule the world forever? Of course, much could be said about each one of these kingdoms, but tonight we're making a quick journey just to understand the prophetic power of the Bible. Well, the 40th verse of Daniel 2, magnificent chapter, says, "And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron." The great English historian, Edward Gibbon, he wasn't a Christian or a Bible believer, but he wrote, in the decline and fall of the Roman Empire, the following: "The images of gold, silver, or brass that might serve to represent the nations and their kings were successively broken by the iron monarchy of Rome." You see, that's exactly what happened. The Bible is always on target. Rome dominated the world from 168 BC to 476 AD. It was in the days of Rome that Jesus Christ was born as a baby. Joseph and Mary fled from an oppressive Roman Empire and traveled down into Egypt. I have to pause for a moment. I love Egypt. It's where I spent my early years growing up. And I love the people of the Middle East. They are wonderful people. Don't ever believe that all people in the Middle East are terrorists. They're people just like you and like me. They love their families. They love God. They love life. Egypt is a wonderful place. But Mary and Joseph went down there in order to escape the oppressive Roman Empire. And Jesus was tried by a Roman governor and crucified by Roman soldiers. For more than 500 years, Rome appeared to be invincible, her flag waving from the British Isles to the Persian Gulf, from the North Sea to the Sahara Desert, from the Atlantic to the Euphrates and beyond. One of the largest empires in the world. But what did the Bible predict? Verse 41. "Whereas you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, the kingdom shall be divided." The Bible did not predict that a fifth world empire would arise after Rome. It predicted a divided empire. Another single world empire would not follow Rome, and never has. The feet of iron and clay represent the divisions of the Roman Empire, and this is exactly what happened. Europe was divided just as the prophecy described that it would be. The barbarian tribes attacked Western Europe in the middle of the 4th century. And during the ravaging attacks, the Roman Empire was divided exactly as the Bible predicted. Well, a man in Europe once asked a preacher, "How do you know the Bible is really true?" "Well, sir," responded the preacher, "you're standing on it." "Oh, what do you mean?" The earth beneath your feet proves it. And then the preacher explained. The Bible predicted that Europe would be divided. Europe today exactly fulfills that prophecy. The skeptic was rather astonished and astounded. The Bible goes on to say, in helping us to understand this particular prophecy, in verse 43, "And as you saw iron mixed with ceramic clay, they will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as iron does not mix with clay." So throughout history, the kings of Europe attempted through intermarriage to unite Europe into one empire. Utterly failed. One famous example of this is when Napoleon divorced his wife, Josephine, and married Louise of Austria to secure relations with that country, Austria, and further his goal of uniting the entire continent of Europe. As prophecy predicted, he utterly failed. The Bible says, "They will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as iron does not mix with clay." Besides intermarriage, there was a second way that the political leaders attempted to unite Europe. They attempted to accomplish their goals through, naturally, conflict and war. Charles V wanted to unite Europe. He failed. Charlemagne wanted to unite Europe. He failed. Napoleon tried to unite Europe. He failed. Napoleon wrote in his journal a description of his ambitious plans. "There will be one Europe, one currency, one language, one government over all of Europe." But when Napoleon was defeated at the Battle of Waterloo in June of 1815, he said this, "God Almighty is too much for me." So the Bible is accurate. The ancient prophecies written hundreds of years before speak to our hearts today. And all attempts to unite Europe for any length of time will have to deal with these few words from an ancient Bible prophecy. They will not adhere to one another. Indeed, this prophecy has been proven true. Europe has been divided. It's been divided through the centuries. Even very recently, with the departure of the United Kingdom or Great Britain from the United Europe, it proves it. They will not adhere one to another. Charles V, Charlemagne, Napoleon, Hitler, Stalin, these were would-be world leaders, and they have failed to unite Europe and the world. Consider Hitler, Adolf Hitler. His fiery speeches whipped up the masses. His motto was, "One people, one empire, one leader." And it appeared at that time that he was going to accomplish his intention and ambition of uniting Europe. The Allied forces were trapped at Dunkirk. For those of you who are history buffs of World War II and of European history, defeat seemed certain. But remarkably, Hitler ordered his tanks to stop and resupply. What stopped Hitler's tanks? An ancient prophecy. In Daniel chapter 2, declares that from the days of the Roman Empire, Europe would never be united. The Bible predicts in the book of Revelation a final last attempt to unite Europe. But this time it will be under a religious political union. Revelation 17, verses 12 to 14. The 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings who have received no kingdom as yet, but they receive authority for 1 hour as kings with the beast. Here is the significance of this prophecy. For a short period of time, the nations of Europe and the rest of the world will enter into a religious political confederation just before the coming of Jesus. Notice how Revelation describes this temporary unity. These are of one mind, and they will give their power and authority to the beast. So the flag that is the symbol of the common market of Europe is many voices, one people. The euro is the result of an effort to seek to establish a common currency for Europe. Revelation tells us there will be this attempt to unite people politically, to prepare for the beast power that unites them religiously and politically under one great system. What if war, conflict, and strife around the world combined with famines and economic failures show us that we are coming to the end of time? And the idea is so sweetly presented that if we united our world, a united society, that we could all become one, wouldn't that be palatable and acceptable to many people fearing what is coming upon the earth? The Bible says these are of one mind, and they give their power and authority to the beast. These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. Now, the reason why we're not interested in an earthly kingdom is because Jesus has promised us a heavenly one. And this prediction in Revelation 17 tells us, "For he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those who are with him are called, chosen, and faithful." So, my dear friends, here in Indianapolis and all over the world as you watch through live streaming, history has followed the prophecy of Daniel chapter 2 like a blueprint and will continue to do so. The political workings of this planet are not just at random. Events that are happening in this world this very minute are a sign that Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, will soon come. His return is the only hope for a world that is standing on feet of iron and clay, ready to crumble. Daniel's prophecy of the image and Revelation's prophecies point us forward to a new time. Daniel chapter 2, verse 34. You watched while a stone was cut out without hands, which struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Verse 44 tells us the God of heaven, which set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. Now, what is that rock that comes and smashes the image? It's the rock of ages, Jesus Christ. We can have no confidence in earthly kingdoms that rise and fall. They are temporary. They are simply illusionary. They come and they go. But we can put our trust in God's kingdom that will never fail. You see, the Bible says it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. So be encouraged. Regardless of what you're facing, whatever your apprehensions are, your concerns about what's going to happen in the stock market tomorrow, don't worry, because hope is on the way. You see, the stone cut out without hands, without human hands, stone cut out by God Himself. It's a supernatural kingdom, and it will come and smash the kingdoms of this world. Revelation 11, verse 15. And there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. Babylon rises and falls. Medo-Persia rises and falls. Greece rises quickly and falls. But He, God, shall reign forever. Rome rises and maintains for a long time, but then falls. But Christ will reign forever and ever. The Roman Empire is divided. The European common market rises and falls. One world government attempts to rise, but it falls. Because beyond it all is God Himself, and He shall rule forever and ever. He will reign. The kingdoms of this world will crumble. You see, the great longing in the heart of the human being is for peace and for security. We long for a stable society where we can bring up our children without the fear of war and poverty and devastating diseases. We want a future that's filled with hope, not with fear. Little illustration for you as we come to the close of our lecture this evening. Pastor George Fisher was a missionary to West Africa. My wife and I had the great privilege of living in Abidjan, Côte d'Ivoire, Ivory Coast, in West Africa for about 9 years. Wonderful people, wonderful region of the world. But Pastor George Fisher was a missionary to the country of Liberia. And he experienced something during the Liberian Civil War. It was a terrible war. He tells this interesting experience that took place one day as he was teaching African ministerial students about the second coming of Christ. He had just quoted those amazing words in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. For the Lord Himself, and this is such a powerful verse, I just love it, these verses. For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. Well, we're going to talk about the second coming in a few days, I'm sure, but when Jesus comes, it's not going to be quiet, let me tell you. He's going to come and a shout with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them, those who have been resurrected, in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Can you say amen? Amen. It's an exciting, wonderful thing. Well, one of his students raised his hand. He said, but Pastor, what will he say when he shouts? Whoa, Pastor Fisher was taken back. Well, that took me by surprise, he said. The student repeated, Pastor, 1 Thessalonians 4:16 says that Christ will descend from heaven with a shout and a loud command. I want to know what that command will be. Well, Pastor Fisher kind of scratched his head. He had to think for a minute. He said, I wanted to leave the question unanswered to tell him that we must not go past what Scripture actually says. But then my mind started wandering to an encounter that I had had earlier in the day with a refugee. Now, this is Pastor Fisher talking, from the Liberian Civil War. The man, a high school principal, told me how he was apprehended by a two-man death squad. After several hours of terror, as the men described how they were going to torture him and then kill him, he narrowly escaped. After hiding in the bush for 2 days, he was able to find his family and then escape to a neighboring country. The escape cost him dearly. In fact, two of his children lost their lives. The stark cruelty unleashed on an unsuspecting, undeserving population had touched me deeply. I also saw flashbacks of the beggars that I pass each morning on my way to the office. Every day I see how poverty destroys dignity, robs men of the best of what it means to be a human. And sometimes it substitutes the worst of what it means to be an animal. And I'm haunted by the vacant eyes of people who have lost all hope. Pastor, you haven't given me the answer. What will he say? The question just hadn't gone away. Enough, I said. He will shout enough when he returns. A look of surprise came on the face of the student. What do you mean enough? Enough suffering, enough starvation, enough terror, enough death, enough indignity, enough lives trapped in hopelessness, enough sickness and death, enough time, enough. One day, Jesus will come. He will blaze down through the corridor of the sky. He will pass those planets that he has created, and one day the earth will shake. One day we'll look up and we'll see him and say, "This is our God whom we have waited for, and he will save us." One day he's going to come, and we will be caught up in the sky for that ultimate space trip. And let me tell you, it will not cost you a dime because it's paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. And one day we're going to rise into that sky and we're going to reign with Jesus forever. I want to be ready for that event. Jesus is reaching out to you tonight. The Holy Spirit is touching your heart, and he invites you to sit on the throne with Jesus Christ, who will reign forever and ever. God asks you to choose to be with him. Tonight, would you like to just signify to God, "Yes, Lord, I want to be part of your great kingdom. I want to not only rule forever with you, I want to be with you forever." Would you just raise your hand wherever you are? Amen. Charles, come and sing to us this amazing song, "No More Night." One of these days, it'll be daylight forever because we will be with the Son of Righteousness, Jesus Christ. Charles, please.
Timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new on that day. Gone is a curse from which I stumble and fail. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No. no more tears, never cry again. Praises to you, the great I Am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. All around, how the nations bow down to sing the only sound of the praises to Christ our King. Slowly the names from the books are read, but you know the King, so there's no need to dread. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. Praises to the great I Am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See over there, there's a mansion prepared just for me, where we will live with our Savior eternally. No more night, no more pain, no never crying again. Praises to the great I Am. We will live in the light of a risen Lamb. Praises to the great
future we have. Amen. Through the blood and grace of Jesus Christ, and following his example, through his power, accepting his justifying and sanctifying righteousness, we can live forever with the Lamb of God, and we can continue to give praise to the great I Am. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we come to you at the conclusion of a fascinating journey and understanding of Daniel chapter 2 and relating to the book of Revelation. These two marvelous books which help us to understand that you are the God of prophecy and that the Bible is accurate and can be fully believed. Now, Lord, as we look to the future and realize we are in the tips of the toes of that statue of Daniel 2. Help us to lean upon you every day. Help us not to be distracted by the cares of this world, even though we have to be realistic, we have to live. But Lord, you will help us day by day to understand that the Lamb of God has made a way of escape for us and has promised us eternal life, and that his soon coming is imminent. Now, Lord, bless each one who has been here tonight, those who have been watching through live streaming all across this earth, wherever they might be. Help them to know that you love them, that you're calling them right now to follow you in every way, so that they too, and all of us who accept you, can be part of that great and wonderful throng that will look up and give glory to the Lamb of God. We thank you for hearing us in this prayer and ask that you will keep each one safe as they depart tonight and as they return tomorrow night. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. God be with you, and just hold for a moment. Pastor Finley has some important announcements for you.
What a powerful presentation tonight on the history of our world and the fact that Jesus indeed is the only answer to the conflict of this world. Tomorrow night is our next meeting. Tomorrow night the topic is the battle for the throne. Revelation, the 12th chapter, verses 7 to 9, John looks up into heaven, he says, there was war in heaven. Satan and his angels fought, or the dragon and his angels fought against Michael and his angels. War there in heaven. Why is there so much sickness, suffering in our world? We're going to look at the cosmic conflict, what's going on behind the scenes, and we're going to focus particularly on the fact that Revelation predicts where we are in time, and it gives us answers to the deepest questions of our heart and life. If you have any questions during the lecture, write them out. I'll have a question box in the back. We're happy to answer those questions, or spend some time with us after the lecture. We're more than happy to spend time with you if you do have questions about a lecture, about anything that's said. Be happy to share and open the Word of God. When you go out tonight, remember as well, tomorrow night, if you have children, there's a complete children's program. Last night, there were about 40 children, 20 staff. Your children are cared for from 4 years old to 10 years old. Be sure to remember the children's program. Tomorrow night, another health presentation as well. Get your lecture on the way out tonight. English, Spanish, French. We're building for you a library of faith. We'll see you tomorrow night. God bless you.